Good, nice to see you. How you been, man?
Good. Thank you again for joining us on this Skype Q&A. We're super excited. We all love Paper Girls, number one. Got a whole bunch of people here that want to ask you some quick questions. And you are, I'm a little biased, you are my favorite writer of all time in the history of comics and hip hop. But by all means, thank you again for giving us some of your valuable time. We are super excited about a Why the Last Man TV show. I'm sure you can't really talk about it or anything, but.
Yeah.
Can't wait, man. We're very, very excited that it's finally happening and coming to TV. Paper Girls 1 was a huge hit for us. Everyone loved it, and it was one of those things, we just can't wait to see what happens next. We know it's a little weird because we're going to ask you questions about a book that we're going to say, wait and see, because it's right around the corner. But I'll step off and let some people come up and ask the first few questions and harass you again at the end. But thank you again for joining us. We really greatly appreciate it. So if the first few people want to come up and ask some questions, come on up.
Absolutely. And Rick, before we begin, just let me thank you for the amount of support you've shown, not just Paper Girls, but all of my books over the years. You are the king of all retailers.
Thank you. It's easy to sell your stuff. I mean, you do such incredible work. So first off, let me get a round of applause for Brian Cable. Thank you for joining us. I'm gonna let Ken ask the first question. All right, thanks, Brian.
Sure.
Hey, how you doing?
Good. Hi, nice to see you.
You too. Hey, Rick is really a big advocate of all your books. Everything. He offers the books to them. If it's something they don't like, gives them money back. My question to you is, when can you come down here for a store signing?
I would love to, but I'm writing 39 comic books now, and I have two children to raise, so I rarely get to leave my basement, much less my state. But as soon as I do, I would love to visit the store, because by all accounts, it's one of the best.
Yes, it is. It's by far the best in Florida, definitely. And we just things slow down, but come down and see us.
Okay, you got it. Right. I promise I will.
Thank you.
Good to meet you.
Hello there. My name's Ben Howard. Big fan since I read the Why the Last Man trades. They were, along with Preacher, just blew my mind and showed me there was a world beyond comics beyond the superhero genre. Also, huge fan of Saga. I actually one of the administrators for the fan page on Facebook.
Oh, thank you for your service.
Yes,
that's very
kind. Of course. We're conferring like 3 to 5 people each day.
It's amazing.
Loved Paper Girls. Loved how it's really felt authentically 80s in terms of how people's how houses looked, how the girls were dressed, the movie posters and all the references. My favorite is still the Freddy Krueger outfit, because, you know, it's like they said, the two biggest people in the 80s, Ronald Reagan and Freddy Krueger.
We've already seen Freddy Krueger. We may be seeing Reagan coming up soon, so stay tuned.
All right, cool. You have to have a horror show, right? Anyway, one thing I noticed in the issue is that the machine that the girls find in the developed house, it kind of looks oddly fleshy, even though it's a piece of technology. Would you consider that a Cronenberg influence, since there's obviously so many 80s references in there?
Sure. You'd have to talk with Cliff, since that's his genius design, but I think you see a lot of H.R. Giger in there, and Cronenberg is definitely an influence, but I think there's also just some of Cliff's own unique weirdness that goes in there, but we'll be seeing more of that shit coming up, I could
All
say.
All right, great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
How you doing?
Hey, how are you?
So, first of all, I was just going to say, you're on this giant screen right now, and you're giving this whole Wizard of Oz vibe, and it's really awesome.
Terrifying.
A little bit terrifying, way more awesome. So anyway, my question is, with at least Saga and now Paper Girls, you've introduced this language. With Saga, it was the blue, and Paper Girls, it was that weird symbol language. And they are translatable. People have, there's been fan sites, they have translated both of them.
What?
Yeah.
Well, that's impossible. They're unbreakable codes.
Well,
they've done it.
My whole question was, what's the thought process in creating those languages, and why do something that was a language that you didn't include a translation note or anything like that to make it obvious what they were saying, basically?
Well, I've been doing a lot of traveling recently for conventions, and I got to go to Portugal and France and Italy, and I always feel like a giant, ugly American when I visit because I speak no other languages. And I can barely have mastery of English. So it's a really dramatic experience to go somewhere and to not know the language. I'm fascinated by the way that language separates us and unites us. So it's definitely been a running theme in my work. And I like sort of playing with language in a way that even if you don't speak blue or understand this alien language, you can sort of by context clues pick up some things. And then for those super dedicated cryptologist readers out there, they get a whole other experience of learning something a bit deeper. So, it's just a pet interest of mine, I guess, languages.
Okay. Well, it's making me want to go into cryptology, so thanks for that.
Thank you.
Thank you much.
Good to see you.
Hey, how's it going? I'm Chris.
Good, how are you?
Nice to meet you. Face-to-face, so to speak.
Yeah.
I have been a long-time fan of yours, and by long time, I mean not very at all. I came into this comic shop the first time to play board games, and then that week, Rick introduced me to Saga number one.
We lost.
Sorry, how'd you do that?
Howdy. I mean, I know I haven't been reading you that long, but you hang up on me.
I was really offended.
As I was saying, Rick introduced me to Saga number one like the first week that I ever came into the shop, and that was the first comic that I ever read. And since then, I have just gone crazy. It's bad on my bank account, whatever. No big deal. I just want to say how much I appreciate all the work that you've done. It's all fantastically written, and
you know,
the artists that you choose to express your vision spot on every time.
Thank you. That's very kind of you.
I have to say, unlike most people, like I know Saga's a crowd favorite, my personal favorite is Pride of Baghdad. So I really, really hope that you should get, or that you get in touch with Disney, make like a new movie, more depressing than Lion King. Be fantastic.
All right.
And it's made better by the fact that my girlfriend was a zookeeper. The first time I made her read it, she hated me for like a week.
Yeah. That's the strangest compliment I've ever received.
It's fantastic. I tried.
Thank you.
Yeah. Do you have any like plans for any other kind of one-shot deals like Pride of Baghdad, or is just gonna be stuck doing long stuff?
Nico Henrichsen, the artist on Pride of Baghdad, I actually just met him for the very first time a few weeks ago at a convention in England. He and I worked together, but we never met, and we had such a great time hanging out. I really miss his work. So, yeah, I'd love to do another standalone graphic novel, and hopefully with Nico. That would be great.
That would be great, because I would buy it, and then I would have
okay. Sounds good.
Appreciate your time. I'm gonna let it go to one of these other pools. Thank you.
Sounds good.
Hi, Brian. I'm Sean.
Hi, Sean. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Not too bad. I'm trying to get the light red on my shiny bald dome. It's not working. But how are you? Cool shirt.
Thank you very much. So obviously I'm a big fan, or I wouldn't be here. I didn't just wander by. But I think my favorite thing that you've done in a while, and I love Saga. I really like the Private Eye a whole lot. I thought it was fantastic. I like the panel flow, just everything you did. I like all the panel syndicate stuff you guys are doing. And I know you've been doing mostly your own thing for a while now, your own creator stuff. Are there any properties or characters that are either creator-owned or mostly associated with specific creators that you would like to have a shot at some point, like ideally, like a dream project?
No.
None.
I'm sorry. I know it's a boring answer, but no, I was really lucky. I got to work in comics for a decade doing stuff in Marvel and DC, and I got to write Spider-Man and Batman and X-Men and all the characters I grew up loving, but it never turned out as well as when I was working on my own creation. So, no, I love those characters, but I think I would rather read Jason Aaron writing Doctor Strange than see more Doctor Strange out of me. So I'm just going to keep making new stuff for now.
Awesome. And also, do you actually feed off of the tears of your fans when you kill a new character?
Yes. Yes, I do. Awesome. It sustains me.
I'm glad we're helping sustain you. Thanks.
Good to meet you.
Hi.
Hello.
My question, I used to love Why the Last Man. I was wondering if you ever had a name picked out for 355, like were you debating whether or not to reveal it or not?
Yeah, I guess I've always known what her name was, and I felt like I'd left clues in the book as to what it might be, but I've only ever seen one person say what they thought it was, and everyone immediately online said that is an idiotic theory and you are stupid. And so I've seen a lot of alternate theories, but there's only ever one right one out there. But it's basically, it's whatever you want it to be is probably more interesting than what's in my head. But I do have an answer for it.
Okay. Not going to share, are you?
No, no.
All right. Thank you.
Sorry.
Hi again.
Oh, hey, you're back.
Yeah. Yes, I won't leave you alone. And the story of Paper Girls has been described as Stand By Me meets War of the Worlds, but are there any other influences from the story? I mean, you explained about how when you were growing up, near the end of the whole Paperboy thing, that girls started taking over or the routes, and that was a big influence. But any other like stories or movies or other things that went into the creation of Paper Girls?
You know, it's less fiction, I think, and more just the experiences. I was 12 years old in 1988, and I was living in a suburb just outside of Cleveland, so I remember this pretty well. But excuse me, also, I asked my mom to send me whatever information she had about me at age 12, just to help jog my memory. And I thought she would send, like, a few photos.
Right.
And she sent me this dossier, this thick binder. It was terrifying. It was every homework assignment that I had ever done, like, any small thing. She had recorded everything. And
well,
it was,
yeah.
It was scary to see that your parents have this file on you, but it was also, it was really helpful because
right.
I got to sort of, you know, see how my memories went up against reality. And I think it was fun just to get to read what was in my head at 12. But
right.
I think now I'm almost 40 years old, so I think of 12-year-olds as just being tiny idiots. They don't know anything, but it's not true. It's I realized like 12-year-old me was pretty fully formed.
Right.
You know, I already knew I wanted to write comic books, and I could sort of see all my interests being formed. So
right.
I think this dossier on young me was more of an influence than
that dossier
anything.
Also like helped with the look of the cover. Uh-oh. No. Are we losing connection?
Nope.
Never mind.
You were breaking up a little bit.
Yeah. This massive, scary dossier also influenced the look of the comic because it looks authentically 80s, not just like a copy of 80s, but 80s 80s. Did that influence?
Well, that's all. Yeah, that's entirely Cliff Chang, who, you know, I tried to make the story as authentic as possible, but who went through every yearbook he had around then, and just to try and do something that, as you say, felt authentic, not like a jokey version of the 1980s with everyone wearing leotards, leg warmers, and beyond, but the way it actually looked. So that's all Cliff.
Cool. Thank you very much.
Sure.
Hey, how's it going?
Good. How are you?
So, thank you for coming, like everybody else is saying. Rick recently helped me out because I needed a little bit of a break from the superheroes. As much as I love it, I just wasn't getting attached to a story. Jumping around Marvel, and Rick introduced me to Why, and I got sucked right in. It was the best thing, best recommendation ever.
Thank you. Thanks to Rick.
Yes, definitely. I got sucked in just because, not just because it wasn't superheroes, besides it being an amazing story, the characters, I recently just finished it. And to make me seem a little bit soft in front of my friends, but it really sucked me in, and I, like, wow. And it's the characters. Was there any influence of yourself or anybody in your life that kind of inspired characters, either in this story or any other stories?
Sure. I mean, you know, York and I are not exactly the same at all. He has a beautiful head of hair, and I do not. But there's some overlap, I think, there. And I think there's probably a lot of my then-girlfriend, now-wife, and Agent 355. And yeah, I think all of my books, each character is sort of a composite of me and people I care about, and then just made up bullshit, sort of equal measures.
Yeah, that's cool. Actually, towards the end, I could kind of see it now. I see you in the big screen there, the last book. I'm not going to give up anything because my wife's actually finishing up the last book. But I noticed that at the end, you kind of look like you're.
That's
not the very end, not the old guy, but the bald. Trust me, as a fellow bald guy, I could see it.
Looking good.
Thanks again, and I'm looking forward to keep reading your stuff. I'm gonna start Saga this week, so.
This week? It's too late. Get on it.
I know. That's what I'm saying. But I am reading Paper Girls too. So, all right.
Thanks, man.
Thank you.
Hi, Brian. Thank you for taking time of the day to come and talk to us. Really appreciate it.
Sure.
My question is, at the Image Expo, you announced you were going to do a Walking Dead story. Is there anything you could tell us about? Who's going to draw it? What characters you're going to use?
Well, it's definitely, I can say it's Marcos Martin is drawing it. He's my partner at Panel Syndicate. And if you guys haven't visited panelsyndicate.com, it's a site that Marcos started, where we put up digital comics and you can pay whatever you want, including nothing, to check them out. But because retailers have been demanding it, we are finally doing this print version. But the sort of the trade-off was, we joked with Robert Kirkman that we'll give Image the private eye if they'll give us Walking Dead. But Kirkman called our bluff and gave us Walking Dead. So Marcos and I are going to do one issue. It's going to be in black and white, which if you've never seen Marcos in black and white, it's going to be totally crazy. And it's canon, I could say. It's set in the universe of Walking Dead, and it counts. It really counts. But we want it to be the kind of thing, if you've never read The Walking Dead, you can enjoy this. And if you love The Walking Dead and you don't want to read our weird thing, you don't need it's pretty important, I think, as stories go. So I think if you love The Walking Dead, you will dig this.
Is it ever going to be in print, like Private Eye will be?
You know, I think like Private Eye, but no plans anytime soon.
Okay.
But I think Robert loved the idea, too, that we do things that are digital, you know, sometimes for years at a time, sometimes forever. So, you know, never say never, but like with Private Eye, don't hold your breath. If you want to read it, digital will be the only way for a long time, at least.
Cool. Well, thank you very much.
Good to see you.
Hi again. So, did it freeze?
Yeah. Hello.
Oh, there it is. Okay. Froze for a second. So, I got another question for you. You've worked on comics, you've worked on television, and now you're working with Why the Last Man, especially. It's going to be a television show and it was a comic book. In terms of writing or creating from there, are there any key differences, or is there any challenges that are different from one or the other? And I know you really can't really tell me that much, I understand that, but is there anything you can say that would be different between, in terms of style, of Why the Last Man comic book and Why the Last Man TV series?
Yeah, no, unfortunately, I know there have been news stories out there, but it's all very early in the process. So nothing I can say specifically about a potential Why the Last Man TV show someday. But my experience has been, my bosses at Lost, Damon Lindelof and Carlton Hughes, were very kind. They said, we love this comic, Why the Last Man, and we think if you can tell a visual story in a serialized fashion in one medium, we think you'll probably be able to do it in another. And I just tried to take everything that I've learned from comics and apply that to television. That, you know, it's always about character first and plot a distant second, etc. But they're very different media, and I prefer comics. It's where I'm happiest. But I'm excited for if anything ever happens. I can't wait to see how it turns out.
Okay. Thank you very much, and thank you for writing everything. I really love Saga. Saga, I think in terms of at least world building, everything in Saga, I think it's almost as good as Star Wars' world building. So
almost as good.
No, I think wrong.
What are you talking about?
It's just as good.
No.
Thank you.
That is high praise, and thank you. Thank you. Did everyone go nuts for the Star Wars trailer?
Nah.
I don't even watch it. I've been spoiled enough. I don't want to see anymore.
Howdy.
Hello.
I got into comics in a very weird way. I kind of came through webcomics.
Cool.
And I eventually started producing them, but by that time I was also into paper comics. I was wondering if you have any insight to do webcomics, like, help the production of paper comics, traditional comics? Or is it like a completely different medium in your eyes?
It's, you know, I guess I know so little about that world, and I'm a technophobe who I don't understand what's happening right now. This is the only time I've Skyped all year. I don't know what I'm doing, but and Marcos Martinez the same way, but we just wanted to challenge ourselves to figure out digital. But I know for us, we're not really fans of motion comics. I think there's some that are very creative, but it feels like most is just combining the worst elements of animation with the worst elements of comics. I don't like motion comics, but I love digital comics. I love having a new vehicle to just read words and pictures. So Marcos and I just thought, no, we figured out how to do print comics, which is pretty hard. We thought digital couldn't be that much harder, and it turned out to be really easy. Anyone, you know, can put pages into a PDF and throw them up onto a website and hook it up to a PayPal. It was easy. It was shockingly easy. So compared to print comics, where you have to figure out printers and distributors and talk to retailers, digital is great. So I think if people want to make comics, don't worry about print at first. Just start making comics and throw them up on Tumblr and get to work.
I also wanted to say, because your comics are so classic, like the first issue tends to be a dollar of like Why the Last Man and Ex Machina. And so I've read a lot of your first issues. And Ex Machina, I think the reveal at the end of the first issue was just a rare moment in comics that you don't experience very often. And that's just really cool. So thank you for that. That was
thank
incredible
you.
Writing.
That's very kind of you.
That's all.
Thank you.
Hello.
Hi.
First of all, thank you for being here. This is pretty cool. I was wondering how much work goes into building a new universe like Saga, and how much doesn't get used? Like, how much do you have in your head that doesn't make it to the paper?
Probably a lot, I guess. You know, I really overthink each planet's currency and what kind of weapons everyone uses. But what I found about world building is a little bit goes a long way, that you just want to concentrate on character first and just put things out in little, you know, drips at a time, I guess. So, yeah, the world is probably fleshed out more in my head. But it also changes, I think, as I sort of see one shitty version in my head since I have no visual sense. But then I turn it over to Fiona, and she sends over a character who looks completely different than what I described, but looks so much better, you know, that it'll sort of inspire a new life. And so it's really a give and take between us. It's not just me being like, I'm the god of this universe and get these details right. It's sort of this playful back and forth between the two of us that hopefully makes it feel like a really lived-in world that's not just one guy's idea.
All right, thanks. That's awesome.
Oh, thank you. Good question.
Hello, Brian.
Hello, of course. Frozen?
Yeah, hang on a second.
Oh, there you go. Oh, you're back. Sorry, Frozen. Good to see you.
Hello, Brian. My name's David.
Hey, David.
My question for you is, with the success of the Walking Dead Fables video games, are there any of your properties that you'd like to have that same treatment done to?
Yeah, you know, Saga is one of those things that I feel like it probably couldn't be a TV show. It's too expensive to do that. It's too weird and adult to be a movie. But a video game is kind of appealing, especially if it's sort of set in the world of Saga. It doesn't step on the toes of the story that Fiona and I are doing. So Fiona loves video games and knows much more about this world than I. So if someone approached us and Fiona liked them and they had a great idea, yeah, I think we'd definitely go to a Saga video game.
All right. Well, thank you.
Sure. Good to meet you.
Hi again.
Hello.
I was kind of curious. I really like your We Stand On Guard miniseries. It's such a huge world that you've created that I'm kind of disappointed that you're only limiting it to a miniseries. So I feel as though there's so much more that can be told. I was just curious why you decided to just go with a miniseries. Is it because of Paper Girls and Saga 3 ongoings would be kind of difficult to keep up with, or?
No, I feel like sort of, especially now that I've cut back on my full-time TV work, that like I'm just getting started. I feel like I've got more comics in me. But no, we Stand On Guard, it was just letting the story dictate the length of it. And I think you'll hopefully see by the sixth issue, you'll get a sense that you got a complete story. And hopefully we want to leave you wanting more and hoping to for us to revisit the 2-4. But I like that not everything I do has to be 100 issues long or 60 issues long, that sometimes you can do something a little more contained. But I'm very grateful you like it though, thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Nicole.
Hi, Nicole.
You spoke to my husband earlier. I haven't finished Y yet. I'm on book 9 of 10.
Oh, boy, I'm stuck.
I love it, though, so far. It's been a great book, and to be honest, I've been binge reading the last 3 of them, trying to finish them before today.
Oh,
work got
you.
In the way, but I'm curious, what made you come up with the Daughters of Amazon? Like, what made you think of that, and how did that come about?
Well, I guess, you know, I wanted to create a lot of different protagonists for York, that I knew he was going to have this lengthy adventure where he's mostly going to be the damsel in distress. He's very rarely the hero in these situations. So, I wanted to have the Israelis sort of as a military component, and you know, you sort of have run into criminals in the States, but I also wanted to have just a cult. Just I think what usually happens after catastrophes is someone smart takes advantage of hungry, frightened people. So I never wanted it to be like, here is our stance on feminism, because obviously it's not. These women aren't feminists, they're lunatics.
Crazy.
With a psychotic leader. But I think Piaguera also is like, I think I'm always happiest writing scenes of people just sitting around talking and sipping tea. And Piaguera is like, let's have some fucking motorcycles and some action. So I think the Daughters of the Amazon were also there for her to keep it visually exciting for those first couple of issues.
Well, I'm really excited to finish it. He is dying for me to finish it so he can talk to me, because he needs someone to stress talk about it.
I hope you don't hate it. Fingers crossed.
Thank you so much.
Good to meet you.
Hi, I'm Sam.
Sam, cool shirt.
Yes, you're not lying. Lion Cat. Anyway, my boyfriend and I are huge fans of Saga, and he's not here right now because he's in class, which was more important. Not really. But he texted me a question he wanted me to ask you. He's a huge fan of mythology, and he tends to notice that in a lot of your works, both in Y and Saga. So he was wondering if there's a specific branch of mythology you liked to draw from or preferred to draw from, and if there was one that you haven't explored yet that you wanted to.
Oh, that's a great question. No, I'm a dope, so I'm not very well versed in mythology, but I took a lot of Greek mythology as a kid, and that was hugely influential. And then I think reading a lot of dramas in film school, particularly the plays of Aeschylus, I just felt were super badass and felt like they were written today. So that was an influence. But no, in terms of mythology, I'd like to learn more about all of them, I suppose, because I know so little. But I think I'm probably like most people of my generation. I think that I'm a weird combination of Star Wars and my strange Catholic upbringing and sort of fused together to create their own mythology that I draw upon. So a lot of Jesus and Darth Vader.
Thank you so much.
Good to meet you.
Hello, Brian. I'm Michael. Nice to meet you.
Hey, Michael.
My question is, Saga is immensely, immensely popular. Obviously, we covered that. Did you ever have was there a moment? And if so, at what moment in the story writing it, did you realize, like, you know, boom, mic drop, this is one of the greatest things ever. This is going to take off.
No, that still hasn't happened. I'm working on me right now. And I'm like, this is now, people are really going to turn on us with this one. So, no, before the first issue came out, I was sure we would get canceled within the first 6 issues. But, it wasn't until probably the end of that first arc that it felt like both Fiona and I clicked together, and it also felt like we saw our numbers weren't just holding steady, but they were starting to go up, and that never happens with books. So, I think by then I started to feel comfortable, probably by the start of the second arc, around issue number 7, but comfortable but never complacent.
All right, good answer. All right, it was nice to meet you. Thank you.
Hello again.
Yes, I said I'm not leaving until this is all over. This is more about a question about writing comics itself. Obviously, making comics, writing the scripts, or doing the arts, or whatever, is very time-consuming. And I'm surprised to hear about writers and artists who have all these various projects going on, and sometimes it's like, you know, do you sleep at night? Ever? Never mind. Connection's got up.
Well, that might have been it.
Oh, hello. We're back.
There we go.
Yeah. Apparently this machine despises me.
Yeah, I guess so. Sorry.
As I was saying, obviously creating comics is a very time-consuming thing, and surprising to learn about writers and artists who's able to do like billions of different projects without seeming to lose energy that we know of. How is like your writing process? How much work do you put into per day with your writing?
Yeah, it's hard to quantify, because if you're saying how long am I sitting at a keyboard doing the physical act of writing, that varies, and it's also, but it, you know, it's more as I'm reading books to my kids at night, or I'm eating lunch, or I'm driving to a meeting, that's writing as well, I guess. So it's, you're constantly thinking about what you're doing. But I'd say all in, I'm not as fast as I used to be. It probably takes me about 10 days to write a script that I'm really proud of. So I've tried to balance my schedule that I only ever have to write, you know, and I'm always ahead enough that I write 3 scripts a month. And I've just been doing it long enough now. I've been writing comics for almost 20 years that it's still not easy, but I'm sort of in a place where I know the ups and downs of it and how long it takes. So, but it's way harder now that I have kids. So if you're an aspiring creator and you don't have kids, this is the glory time. Just be writing your ass off all the time. It's harder.
Would you recommend any kind of like amount of time you should dedicate to writing, or how many pages per day you should write, or like what you should do to prepare yourself to write?
There's an old rule that every writer has 10,000 pages of shit in them, and I think that's probably true. They're like Why the Last Man and Runaways and The Hood. Those all happened for me at around the time I've been writing, trying to force myself to write, you know, 5 pages a day, every day of my life, 7 days a week since I was in high school. And I probably hit that 10,000 right around then. So yeah, I think that's pretty good. If you can write 5 pages a day of anything, comic script, bad diary entries, nonfiction, poetry, but if you just do 5 pages every day, on the weekends, on the weekdays, like you're not allowed to play video games until you've got your 5 pages out. You just find that after 3 months of doing it, your body will feel weird if you take a skip day. Your body will be like, oh, I miss getting those pages out. So do it. If you can do 3 months in a row, 5 pages a day, every day, 7 days a week, you'll be off to the races. It'll make you want to do it forever. And if you do that for a year, 2 years, you just see like your stories stop sucking and they start being what you want them to be in your head. Right. So, but there's no easy fix. Here's just this one book to read or this one class to take, but it's just exercise. It's just repeating doing it every day, 5 pages a day.
Right. Thank you very much. That actually helps me a lot since I want to be a writer. Thanks again, and you're probably one of the best writers out there right now, and just continue being excellent. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, you're too kind. Thanks, man.
Hi there, I'm Ashley.
Hi, Ashley.
First, I just want to say that I very much appreciate that they pretty much fell in love because of a book in Saga. That was excellent. Very well done, and something to aspire to.
Oh, that's very nice.
But I recently picked up We Stand on Guard, and I haven't finished it yet. I finished the first one, and I'm hoping to pick up the rest as I go. But my question is, well, more of a statement. The War of 1812.
Uh-huh.
No one remembers, discusses, talks about the War of 1812. Why did you pick that as something to allude to? I know your wife's Canadian.
Yeah, that was definitely, it was the start of it, and I think when she was born in Canada, but became an American citizen, and at the, you know, during the process of getting her citizenship, they asked her, you know, would you be willing to take up arms against your country of origin? And I thought that was hilarious, the thought of Canada and the United States going to war, but, you know, then I wanted to research, and so many of my collaborators and friends are Canadian, the sort of history of our country, and you realize, yeah, it wasn't that long ago that we were enemies, and it wasn't that long ago that the United States was planning for the contingency that we might be enemies again. So, yeah, I think like most comics, it's just me realizing I have a film school education. I know almost nothing about the real world. So if I can use comics to force myself to learn a little bit of history, it'll be good. So this is an excuse to learn about that war.
You may want to bother her about some more Canadian history. It's actually hilarious, a lot of it. Let's see.
Are you Canadian, by the way?
No, I was a history major in college. I actually took class specifically just on Canadian history. But, for example, there was a prime minister during one of the wars who believed he could commune with Queen Victoria and get war advice from her, which is doubly hilariously because she does not know anything about war. So, yeah, hit your wife up about some more Canadian history.
Yeah,
it's just
I will.
Hilarious.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Joe, and I work with Humanoids Publishing.
Oh, hey, Joe, how are you?
I think
you guys do great stuff.
And I think you were with one of my coworkers, Tim Pilcher, at that recent convention where you met Nico. So, I'm going to ask you a very hard-hitting question. Would Alana make a good paper girl?
Would Alana from Saga make a good paper girl?
Yes.
That is a great question. No, she would not. She would do great for the first 3 days and then decide she hates waking up that early or get into a fight with a customer on her route or, no, she doesn't quite have the business acumen or temperament for paper girl lifestyles.
All right, well, I can die happy that I got that answer.
Thank you. Give my best to Tim, too, will you please?
Will do.
Hello again.
Hi.
I was wondering if there are any writers currently out there in comics that you particularly can't wait to read the next issue of, or that maybe you think aren't getting as much attention as maybe they should for their abilities.
Well, I mentioned Jason Aaron before, but I think he gets more than enough credit for his considerable abilities, so fuck that guy. there's somebody does web comics named Julia Wirtz, who I discovered her because she had a book called Drinking at the Movies, which I thought was a spectacular title, and I love her work, so... Yeah, Julia Wirtz, if you've never read her before. She's one of my favorite writers. Mainly does funny autobiographical or historical comics, and I think she just has a great voice. So, yeah, check out her stuff.
Is it just in or just on the web, or is it in print form, do you know?
It's a lot of her stuff, like she's doing stuff for The New Yorker now that goes to the web. So, yeah, most of it's on the web first. So, yeah, if you just Google Julia Wirtz, W-E-R-T-Z, it'll take you to her site and a whole history of her work. I think you'll dig her.
Awesome, thanks.
Sure.
So I'm a, I love pretty much everything you write, but my favorite thing that you've done is Ex Machina.
Oh, thanks.
If you had continued with that book, where would Mitchell have wound up? Where would he have gone?
Yeah, well, I guess it, you know, it probably would have followed to modern days, and I guess without spoiling it for anyone, we see that he's sort of taken on a new job at the by the end of the series. So I think he would be continuing in that position till right now, but yeah, I think maybe we'd be seeing some Mitchell 100 Donald Trump showdowns. Makes me sad that I'm not still writing the book, but. Yeah, I think Mitchell would still be at it, making uncomfortable decisions for what he thinks is the good of the country.
Cool, thanks.
Sure.
Hello, back again. Another question I had. I've heard that a book that really inspired you was a book called Story by Robert McCann. And it turns out that unbeknownst to you, he's your father-in-law. Like, one, is that true? And two, how did that book inspire you?
I've never heard that before. It is absolutely not true. But it is, yeah, Robert McKee wrote this book, Story, which is, it's a terrific book on story. And I'm married to a woman whose last name is McKee, but they're not related at all.
Okay.
So, but it's a terrific book. If you're a screenwriter, I think McKee just has very practical advice. And I think like most books about writing, it's a good diagnostic. Like, you shouldn't start there. You think you should just write from your heart and see what's inside you. But when you realize what's inside your heart stinks and is not fun to read, then read something like Story and find out maybe where you went wrong and how to get back there. But so we're related in spirit, but not
true. All right, cool. All right, thank you.
Sure.
Hi.
Hello.
I just want to say thank you because Saga actually got my sister into comics. She wouldn't pick up one until she read Saga, so thank you.
Well, thank you.
I also want to ask you, does music inspire you? And if so, what type of music?
Yeah, I'm not one of those writers who can write with music on. Like, I am so easily distracted. I just have to sit in silence in a room with four white walls. But when I'm just thinking about stuff or just walking around with my headphones on, definitely. And it's usually female songwriters or sad boys with glasses, I guess, that I listen to. But Yeah, there's a band called the Eels, not the Eagles, but the Eels, E-E-L-S. They're probably my all-time favorite band, and I love them. But Run the Jewels, I've been listening to a lot recently. So I like to think I have pretty eclectic, weird taste, but I'm also old, I realize. So I don't know most of what's new and good. But what should I be listening to, if you could tell me to get
an album? Female singers, I would say Brody Dale. She used to be in a band called The Distillers, but she has more recent stuff that's just solo work, and she's amazing. So,
cool. All right, I'll check her out. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, Brian. How's it going, buddy?
Good. How are you?
Doing all right. Quick question. So, for Sin City, Frank Miller stood behind the camera with Rodriguez to go ahead and make it. You had any desire for any of your work to stand behind the camera?
No, probably not, I guess. Because I think I love being a writer. And in comics, I'm the equivalent of the screenwriter. And someone like Fiona Staples is the equivalent of the director and the actor and the lighting designer and the cinematographer. They do everything. And that's really hard. And I'm lazy and old. And so now, I think I do sometimes think about directing, but if I were ever going to direct, I think it would be something original that I intended to be a movie from the beginning. Because for something like Why, or Ex Machina, I feel like I already told that story once. It's hard to work up the energy to do it again. So if I were to direct, it would be for something completely new.
Okay, just let us know. We'll go see it.
Okay, you got it.
Thanks, bud.
Thank you.
Brian, my name's Leah.
Hi, cool t-shirt again.
Thank you. Love it. I was just wondering, why did you choose a cat to, I understand the whole concept of the lion cat, but why did you choose a cat of all animals?
I mean, haven't you ever met a cat before? Don't they know when you're full of shit?
That's true.
I love my dog, but he's a dope. You can lie to him all the time. He's so trusting. But cats, I don't own a cat, but any interaction I've had, I just get the sense they don't like me or trust me, and rightfully so.
Well, now that Rick knows you're a cat person, I'm not sure if he's going to like you as much.
Interesting. I didn't know. Rick is Rick does not like
person.
Cats.
He hates cats.
Okay. Well, like I say, I'm a dog person too, so I've never owned a cat, but I appreciate their terror.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
Hello again.
Hi.
I wanted to know, what was your favorite comic to write, and what do you think is your best comic?
Sorry, what was my favorite comic to write, and what was the second part?
What do you think is your best comic?
Oh, man. My favorite to write. I've never had a fun time writing. Writing is always work for me, and it's a bit of a chore, so it kills me whenever I hear one of my fellow writers say, that issue just wrote itself, because that's never happened to me except once. By the final Runaways issue 18, which was going to be the end of maybe the whole series, but the first time it came to a close, was an issue that I wrote really fast, and it did feel like it just wrote itself. So that was the one time I was like, wow, it would be fun if it were always this easy. I hope it's the one I'm writing right now, or else I should quit.
Okay. Cool. Thank you.
Thanks.
How you doing, Brian? I'm Chris.
Hey, Chris. How are you?
All right, sir. Stephen King and you worked on Under the Dome together. Mm-hmm. What was it like to try and finish up that writing and filling in the gaps for him to bring it to TV?
Yeah, it was terrifying because that guy's a legend, and he's one of the reasons I am a writer, and I totally revere him. So, but he made it very easy because he's such a great human being, and you know, he said your job is not to put my book up on screen. It is to try and do something completely new for people who've already read the book and want a different experience, or for people who've never encountered it. So he gave us a lot of freedom, but mostly through talking to him, I was just jealous because I worked on that pilot for 3 years. I think he was like, Brian, I wrote 3 novels in the time that you have been working on one episode of television. And then I was like, yeah, I really miss the speed of getting to own and control your work. So he mostly just inspired me to get back to comics, I think.
Very cool. So you're away from Hollywood now at this time?
Yeah. I'm just enjoying comics and raising my kids. And I'm open to things that might come my way, but I'm not actively seeking them out.
Right. Very good. I noticed you were doing executive producer on Under the Dome.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Did you say, was I an executive producer?
Yes, I noticed. I believe you were executive producer on some of the episodes.
I was, yeah. Just for the first season. And then I decided after that was really when I just missed my children. And I realized, I'm not going to be able to do Saga and be executive producer of a network TV show. So something had to give. So I was sad to leave, but happy to have more time to make all these new books I'm working on now.
Thanks very much for your time. Nice meeting you again.
Oh, sure.
Take care.
Good to see you. Right on.
Hi again. I don't know how anyone didn't ask this question. What got you into comics? Like, what was the book that really got you into all of this?
When I was a little kid, probably like in first grade or kindergarten, whenever I'd be homesick from school, my parents would bring me home comics from the drugstore. Which I don't know if that anyone other kids, but I've met enough people who fell in love with comics while they were sick, and it makes me think there was just something about me having a fever that if they had just brought me home like Sports Illustrated, I'd be super into football or something. But comics wormed their way into my brain, and it was a Spider-Man comic, but I loved it. But I also, and I've told this story so many times, I don't remember if it's true or not, but I choose to believe it is. I remember that I would cut up comics. I thought they were like an activity book, but the panels you were supposed to cut out and put them in the right order. So I'm sure somewhere in my childhood home, they're just like valuable, amazing Spider-Man early issues that are just chopped up with like Heathcliff Sunday comic strips. So,
cool.
But yeah.
Cool. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello.
Hi.
So you said earlier that a lot of times the artists that you work with will present something that's way different from your mental image. So especially with Saga, I know there's a lot of leeway because it's so far removed from reality. So what was kind of the greatest deviation, most surprising deviation that Fiona Staples came up with one of your characters? Which character do you feel was kind of the...
Well, I mean, I think the biggest one is Goose, the little seal guy from Saga, was someone that I never even thought was going to be in the book. That was just a character sketch that Fiona sent me and was like, what do you think about this guy? Could he be in our book? And I was like, he can't just be in it. The whole book is suddenly about this guy. I was in love with him. So, yeah, it's not just her drawing something differently than I... And it's her to sometimes, and we talk between every arc, and she'll just throw out a little idea that will sort of spin off and making an entire world. And this new issue that's coming out next month, you'll see, introduces a very cool new character that was just an offhanded suggestion that she made. So, I love it. It's so nice to work with artists who are not just great artists, but are also gifted storytellers with huge imagination. So I steal from them as much as possible.
Do any of her suggestions or characters inspire you to change the story at all?
Sorry, you broke up there a little bit. Did you say again?
Do any of the character designs that she comes up with or characters that she pitches to you inspire the story to change in any way, shape, or form?
Yeah, definitely. I'd say like the Will and Lion Cat were two characters that I sort of envisioned one way in my head as these sort of implacable badass killers. And then when I saw her first sketch of them, I was like, oh, he's just kind of a sad big kid, the Will. I'm like, I understood him in a completely different way, and he became a really different character. So, yeah, that's happened just about every time I get download a file from Fiona. The character goes from being sort of two-dimensional in my head to a fully rounded character, so it's awesome.
Break it again.
So, I think up till now you haven't really let this slip, but what is 355's real name?
We already asked. He said.
Oh, he didn't?
He didn't tell you.
He said that only one person got it right.
Yeah.
And he refuses to tell
us. It's in there somewhere. Read it two more times and you'll discover.
Is there any likelihood it'll be brought up in the show at all, you know? Like, is that a possibility?
I don't even know if there will be a show.
Oh, okay.
So stay tuned.
Okay.
What's up, bud?
Hi.
So my question is, I'm the blasphemous person here. I don't read Saga. I know. Shut up. But like, I like a lot of your current and newer stories, like Who Stand on Guard, Paper Girls. Those are the things I'm actually really enjoying the most of. What would, like, going to Paper Girls, I had somebody ask you what you drew for inspiration or not. What was really your striking thing for Paper Girls? Like, where did you come from to get some inspiration for that?
I think it just being old and then sort of thinking back to when I saw Stand By Me with my dad when I was a 10-year-old kid in the theater. We were the distance between then and when my dad were those characters' ages that I am now from Stand By Me. No, none of that's making any sense. But I suddenly realized, oh shit, I'm old. I barely remember my past. And do I remember it, too nicely? Am I too nostalgic for the 1980s, which were in a lot of ways a sort of dark, terrible time? And so I think this is a book about nostalgia and sort of coming to terms with my past and all of our past, I guess.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, Joe again.
Hey, Joe.
I know, like, you and Brubaker, you basically can just come up with any concept and image will publish it, but how do you pick your artists?
I guess if someone I like reaches out to me, I guess, and something that's Steve Strauss and I met at a movie, and I guess Fiona, I sought her out. Steve Niles recommended her, and Cliff Chang and I are old friends. He drew a Swamp Thing story 15 years ago, so it's different. Sometimes it's an arranged marriage. Sometimes it's a blind date with someone that you hope it's going to work out with, and sometimes it's one of your oldest friends. So it's basically wherever I can find someone who's willing to draw my weird shit, I'll take it.
Have you ever had a time where somebody like auditioned for the and didn't work out?
No, I can't imagine. I have to say, most artists really aren't that interested in working on creator-owned stuff, I've found. It's much sort of safer financially, I think, and you're going to have a built-in audience to do a Marvel or DC character. Those are usually characters they grew up loving. So it's hard when you go to an artist and say, I have a book about four 12-year-old girls who ride bicycles, which are a pain in the ass to draw. It's not like people are beating down the door to come work with me. So, I'm very lucky I've gotten to work with the artists who are brave enough to draw my weird shit.
All right, well, thank you very much.
Thank you, Joe.
Yeah,
one final time, I promise, and hopefully the computer won't crash.
Fingers crossed.
Anyway, so this is a two-part. One, what's current tile's image and otherwise would you recommend? And number two, what do you hope for the comics medium in the future? Oh. Did we forget?
Okay, so, yeah. Oh, that's part one?
Yeah, part two is what do you hope to happen in the comics medium in the future?
Well, comics I like now from Image. I still love Copperhead. Really okay. Smart sci-fi western that Jimmy Ferber writes, and I just think it's lovely. Just a fast-paced, cool, sophisticated bit of science fiction. And I mostly follow writers, so Jason Aaron, whatever he's up to, Southern Bastards is great. His new goddamn book looks incredible. So yeah, those Image books are great, and my hope for the future of comics—I have more of the same. I got to say that there was a few years ago that everyone was so down on comics, and we were like, we were afraid that our brick and mortar comic retailer friends were going to go to the way of record stores, you know, and disappear. But it hasn't happened. It feels like retailers are thriving, and digital is bringing in an entirely new audience. And you know, I think I'm usually with Rick that I think the alternate covers are a little silly. We're probably drowning in too many of those, but that feels like nitpicking in a time where, you know, I've been writing comics for a while, and there's never been a better time to be a creator, particularly an Image, where I get to own the work completely with my collaborators. You know, we get a no strings attached contract where, you know, we really have total control over it and are not edited. No, I don't think there's ever been a better time. So I hope comics don't fuck it up. I hope we just continue on this good track.
Comics, don't fuck it up, please. Thank you very much. Again, this was a great opportunity.
Oh, thanks. Thank you, guys.
Okay, I got a quickie for you. If you could go back in time and have super persuasive powers and speak any language, what artist would you want to work with in history?
Oh, in history?
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, if any of the Ninja Turtle artists, I guess, went with Vinci, or that all sounds pretty good, but I'm not that sophisticated. I like contemporary artists. I'd rather I take Frank Quietly over Monet, even though I'm sure Monet would do a badass comic. Give me some of that sweet Quietly goodness.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
Like I get to be the lucky last person to ask questions. This one actually comes from my girlfriend who is on the road right now. She had the work conference or whatever, so she's missing out. But I will be sure to relay the answer. She wants to know, as a big animal enthusiast, if you happen to know how Fiona like drew all of her inspiration for the various animal like hybrid creatures in the universe. Like the girl Marco was trying to hook up with, she obviously a bat, you know, Moonies are part ram and all that. So if there was any kind of insight into that inspiration.
Yeah, no, I mean, she's not a zookeeper or anything. I wish there was an awesome answer that she had access to all of these. But she's just a genius artist who can draw anything, you know. And I think I realized when I saw that first splash page of The Stalk, I was like, wow, she is one of the great designers of all time. So I should just back off and let her imagination run. So yeah, I'm just addicted to creating new characters for her to draw. So I'm just hoping this next arc, she's going to be drowning. And we're just going to have hundreds of new characters. So be on the lookout.
So do you just like give her a description of what you're kind of looking for and then just like go ham?
Yeah, like as basic as Marco and Alana, or Marco is a handsome guy with horns who has a sword, and Alana is a badass mom with a ray gun and wings. And she sent over a few different versions. And yeah, if you haven't read the Saga Book One hardcover, there's a lot of cool extras and sort of never before seen stuff about that. So if I can plug, if Rick has any copies left, check it out. But yeah, I mean, it's based on just lucky to work with one of the great artists working today. I try not to get in her way.
That's pretty rad. Again, appreciate your time, and I'll go ahead and give it back to Rick now.
Sure.
All right, Brian, Rick, one more time to close it out. Thank you again so much for all your insightful answers and stuff. We certainly appreciate it. We're all giant fans of your work. And yeah, everyone had a great time. So thank you again for joining us. And and we look forward to more work. Any idea we may see your next? I know you just launched Paper Girls, but if I could clone you and you write 20 books a month, that'd be great, because I can't get enough of your stuff as a fan and as a retailer. But any idea when your next comic project may be beyond Paper Girls? Like maybe 6 months or a year, or is it way down the road, or what?
I know this is no fun for you as a print retailer, but I'd say before the end of the year, you can be on the lookout for something new from Marcos and me from panelsyndicate.com.
Cool.
Something that might be in print eventually, but I think that's enough number ones for any human being to release in 1 year at that point. That's an obscene amount. So after that, I'll just sort of want to, you know, keep going for as long as I can, and we'll see what happens.
Awesome. Well, thank you again for your time. Let's get a big round of applause for Brian K. Vaughan.
You guys are so lucky to have Rick for a retailer and to have such a great store in your neighborhood. I'm jealous of you guys, but thank you for coming and staying out till 9 o'clock, you weirdos. Go out and drink. What are you doing in a comic
book? We're about to.
Awesome. All right. Thanks again, Brian. Thanks so much for your time.
Thanks, guys. Have a great night.
All right, man. Awesome. Later. Thanks.